Nashville. Public television. You make it happen.
Sneak Previews intersection with Richard Gere, torn between wife Sharon Stone and mistress Lolita Davidovich. Blink, a romantic thriller with Madeline Stowe and Aidan Quinn. And a family find at your local theater, Iron Will, a rousing adventure about an epic dog sled race covering 500 miles of wilderness. Plus three more titles, all on this week's Sneak Previews.
Something was going on.
Yes. I thought you were working late. Are you in love with her? I'm sorry, isn't that the traditional question? I say, are you in love with her? And then you say, well, I don't know, I'm very confused, I need some time. And then I respond...
Look. I didn't plan this.
I believe that.
What does that mean?
I'm the planner. You're the creative one. Isn't that the deal? Isn't that what this whole relationship is based on?
I'm going to a hotel.
Really? Now, just when we're finally really getting to know each other. Vincent, are you all right?
What do you mean, am I all right?
Because, honey, you're acting a little crazy.
What the hell is wrong with you? Don't you know what I just said to you? I love another woman. I don't care. I don't care. I'm leaving you. Do you understand that?
I heard you.
It's amazing.
Oh, really? And how is that?
Do you ever consider, maybe, just maybe, maybe, if you just felt this a little more upset, it wouldn't have happened. Don't you?
That was Richard Gere, of course, about to leave his icy wife, Sharon Stone, for another woman in a pivotal scene from Intersection about three people facing an explosive crisis in their lives. I'm Jeffrey Lyons.
And I'm Michael Medved, and one of the most unusual aspects of Intersection, which is just one of the six titles we cover this week, is the way that this movie is set up. It begins with Richard Gere's speeding car going into a skid, and we don't know whether he lives or dies as the picture goes into a series of flashbacks. One of them shows Gere, who plays a wealthy architect, and the other woman, Lolita Davidovich, after they move in together. She plays a feisty Vancouver newspaper columnist who's captivated Gere, even though he's not quite ready to break all ties with his wife and daughter.
Yeah, we can do that.
Great.
I'll go get the car this afternoon so we get started pretty early. What?
Why do you do that?
What do you mean?
Why do you leave it at her place?
Not because I don't need it in town.
Why don't you leave it at my place?
Because we have your car there. It's convenient. There's a garage. Why are you doing this? Please stop. I don't want to do it anymore.
You don't live with her anymore, but your car still does. Is that it? What else do you leave there? A toothbrush? Maybe a pair of slippers?
A daughter.
Later, wife and mistress meet unexpectedly at a glittering reception.
How are you?
Fine.
I read your column. It's very good. It's very clever.
Thanks.
I recognized you from your photo.
You too?
Excuse me?
It's a passport photo.
Really? It's very nice. I like it.
Well, you know what they say? If you look anything like your passport photo, you're not well enough to travel.
Hi, Megan.
Hi.
Well, it's nice to have met you. At last.
Likewise.
Yes. I guess that's what you call a home court advantage.
Well, Michael, you know, this is a movie that I didn't think I would like, and is it the first movie I can tell people I know to go see? No. Is it the 10th movie? Maybe not, but it's January, there's nothing else around. This is nothing more than what is a glitzy, flashy, romantic triangle. And for Sharon Stone, who auditioned for this role, by the way, a surprising come down. I give her credit for taking a secondary role here. She's the wife, but she doesn't have that big a part, considering her stardom. And I rather like this film, despite my better instincts.
Boy, does that ever sound like a lukewarm
endorsement. That's all it is. Again, it is what it is.
I'm glad it's not
absolutely
more than that. I thought Intersection was an absolute disaster, a car crash of a movie. Everything's wrong with it. I mean, first of all, you just don't care about the central character. He is such a pampered punk. He's really, I mean, here's this guy who is living in a gorgeous mansion in one of North America's most livable cities, driving a slick Mercedes, having to choose between these two gorgeous women. Poor baby. Would they sort of throw this up like his dilemma is one of the great tragedies confronting humankind?
I don't think that was the focus of the movie. I don't think the movie was trying to be anything as profound as you think it was.
Well, sure it was. That's why they start with him facing death.
Yes.
And you don't know until the end of the movie whether he lives or dies, and you don't care.
You always run a risk in doing flashbacks. I'm surprised Mark Rydell, who did The Cowboys and did On Golden Pond and did For the Boys, used the flashback, and at times you don't know when certain events happen. Is it a flashback or a flashback within the flashback? I give him credit for using Vancouver and calling it Vancouver instead of having it double for someplace else.
It's a great city, and
I don't think we were supposed to have pity for this character. I think we were just supposed to say it's the strange quirks of fate. That's
if you don't have pity for him, how can one watch the movie with any kind of satisfaction?
I'll tell you how.
I don't see
made me care.
Well,
she gives the performance of her career here. That's the one I care about.
I think she's miscast. They're both miscast. In other words, Sharon Stone comes to the part with a sort of dangerous femme fatale edge she always has. Lolita Davidovich has sort of this girl next door quality. They should have reversed roles. The other thing about this movie was co-produced by Bud York, and you remember he did a film about a similar situation that we both liked very much called Twice in a Lifetime with Gene Hackman.
Yes, I like this fine picture, Brian Dennehy.
Right, because the characters in that film were self-aware. I think the problem here is Richard Gere shows you no reason why either of these women would care about it.
Well, I think the problem is you look for much more here than was intended, and it has flaws, but it is what it is, just a romantic, fluffy movie we'll probably forget about a month from now.
I hope so.
Well, next up is Blink, an intense thriller starring Madeline Stowe as a young Chicago musician blinded 20 years ago, who then goes for transplant surgery, hopeful it will restore at least some of her lost eyesight.
No depth perception now. Here I am.
Hello, Dr. Kerr. It's as nice as to see you.
Aidan Quinn plays a homicide detective who questions her after she's used her blurry new vision and reported something unusual in her apartment.
You heard some suspicious noises upstairs, and you hear this guy coming down the stairs. You look out, and you spoke to him. That was last night, but you didn't see it till this morning?
That's right, yeah.
So what is that? I mean, your eyes are driving the train, and your brain's the caboose that hasn't caught up yet?
I guess you could say that, yeah.
So your eyes are having a delayed reaction to reality?
I don't know how to explain this. It's something that happens with some people who've had this kind of surgery, but we're a little off track. I came here to tell you that I think something's really gone wrong.
Okay, it's all right. Okay.
Thank you.
How long were you blind?
Are there any cops around here who work, or do you all just sit around and drink coffee?
Ooh.
Mm. Later, as the mystery deepens, so does their relationship.
This?
Pearl Jam.
God, you're eclectic. What's this one?
This is the Drovers.
You're kidding.
Yeah.
You bought ours?
Yeah. That night I saw you guys, they were selling them in the hallway.
God, you're like one of three people who bought it.
No. I'm all three people. Of course, I was drunk. Figured I could give them away for Christmas presents.
I think I could fall in love with you.
Thank you, I guess.
You're welcome.
Unfortunately, I gotta go to work today.
I don't know if they're going to cook the CDs, but this plot cooks up two of the oldest gimmicks in the book. Number one, the cop who falls inevitably in love with a star witness. And number two, the blind woman in jeopardy. But it works somehow because of the romantic chemistry between these two. They are just great on screen together. I mean, I think any man in the audience who hasn't already fallen in love with Madeline Stowe is going to have this picture do the job. And just watching these two together and watching the depth of the characters as they're written, I think makes this picture very watchable.
See, I love Madeline Stowe. I didn't find any chemistry between them. I thought the film had a dreary look about it, and it makes its point over and over again and relies on this visual example of how she may be able to see something and not, and all these special effects, they get tedious. And finally, the end of the movie, when she finally confronts the killer, it's not anything exciting. It's nobody you care about, nobody you expect,
oh, gosh,
and all the pieces are supposed to fall into place. It is so predictable.
I couldn't disagree with you more. I think that they make her character enough sort of off-center. She's not a completely likable, sweet, innocent person. She's a difficult person.
And somebody you're not going to want to care about?
No, I'm saying it is someone you want to care about because someone who's believable and yet is very intelligent and very passionate, and the way they interact together I think is fascinating to watch. This is directed by Michael Apted, and you talk about the sort of dreary look. Apted did, of course, Coal Miner Daughter,
right.
And he's primarily known as a documentarian for those British documentaries, Seven Up and
right.
What have you. And I think, like a good documentarian, he uses details, even little details in the apartment, details in their lives, to tell you a lot about these people.
Did you ever watch a murder mystery on TV, like in a one-hour show, and it's 10 minutes before the end of the hour, and they haven't caught the killer yet, and you look at your watch, and you know they have to do it? Well, that's the sense I got here, and maybe Madeline Stowe needs to get new kind of roles. I'm tired of seeing her in danger all the time.
You know
she's
what?
A very good victim, but enough already.
But she's also, I think she's better in this film than anything she's been in. And also, I disagree with you about the climax. I really was surprised when it turned out when they reveal who the killer is and the motivation.
They all happened in the last 2 minutes of the movie.
All right, well, next up is a most unusual movie with a most unusual cast. It stars Willem Dafoe and Nastassia Kinski and Peter Falk and, yes, an up-and-coming young actor named Mikhail Gorbachev in his feature film debut. Now, the name of this picture is Far Away So Close, and it's German director Wim Wenders' follow-up to the triumphant Wings of Desire, about invisible angels haunting the city of Berlin, silently watching all the follies and frailties of human beings. Later, the angel Cassiel, played by Otto Sander, makes a switch from heavenly messenger to ordinary human being, joining old pal Peter Falk, who earlier made the same transition.
Hey! You made the switch. Well, good for you. What's your name?
Cassiel. No, Karl Engel now.
Engel now, very good. When did it happen?
Not so long ago. But I feel much more happier than ever before.
You see, I didn't promise you too much. You want a coffee?
No, thanks. I have a problem.
What is it, money? Papers?
That's solved.
Well, is there anything I can do to help you?
Can you tell a good story?
A good story? Does it have to be true?
No, in the opposite. It has to be phony as hell.
This is a very strange request.
Can you do it for me? For a very exceptional situation?
Caselli, life is a very exceptional situation.
And that was Willem Dafoe there in the doorway, who plays Emmett Flesty, which, as you spell it backwards, is time itself. They could have saved the trouble and named him Otto Kayak, right? I don't know. You know, after a while, this movie is a little bit tedious. It's reminded me of a skit from Saturday Night Live where Mike Myers plays Dieter of German cinema, German television. You know, this esoteric German cinema goes only so far. They constantly switch from black and white to color, and I'm voting a very respectful no on it.
You know, I didn't find it esoteric at all. I think anybody could enjoy this movie for its lyricism, for its poetic visuals, and for just the air of weirdness that is constantly surprising. There's some of the movie that doesn't work. There's sort of a subplot where the angel, played by Otto Zander, becomes sort of an assistant to a mafia chieftain and former Nazi, played by Horst Buchholz. That doesn't work very well, but it's all fascinating.
If it had been a little bit shorter, a little bit more concise, I might have been able to get into it, but it seems so self-indulgent. And yes, I suppose that Wenders had to make a sequel to Wings of Desire now that Germany has united, and now that East Berlin and West Berlin are one city, and he filmed it entirely in East Berlin. I think he had too much to say, if you can believe that. I think it just goes on and on, and it just lost its focus.
Look, again, any film that combines those people in the cast and has Mikhail Gorbachev being very convincing playing himself and Lou Reed being very convincing playing himself has something to be recommended.
I've now seen every Mikhail Gorbachev movie so far. Well, next up, back to reality somewhat, is the movie called The Scent of Green Papaya. Now, this is the first film ever submitted by Vietnam for Oscar consideration. This is the story of a 10-year-old farm girl who goes to work as a domestic in a Saigon household in 1951. This is a strange, almost stark movie in which there are long stretches with very little dialogue as it covers a decade of the girl's life. And much of the film examines the everyday details of her chores, such as this scene, in which she simply tries to clean a floor despite the presence of one of the master's spoiled children.
Well, that was not necessarily a critical response there at the end. I actually like this movie very much, and I think it's a fascinating film, particularly to come out right now, as a counterpoint to Oliver Stone's Heaven and Earth, because the central character here is precisely the same kind of person. It's a very young girl from a peasant village in Vietnam, but this film gives you a sense of the richness and the detail and the reverence for tradition in authentic Vietnamese culture, and I found it very moving, almost sort of a Saigon version of Upstairs, Downstairs.
Oh boy, are you giving a lot more credence to this movie than it deserves. I mean, this film looked to me like a long cooking video. We see details of how she prepares all the dishes, and yes, it is another mindset.
That was the life of the character.
Yes, but it doesn't mean that it translates.
Life was rooted.
But it doesn't mean that it translates to interesting cinema. Yes, it was her life, and yes, it was
medial. And the taste.
I didn't get
any of it. I mean, I felt like it was immediately launched into the lives of these people.
And I thank God that I wasn't forced to live that life. It's a very different mindset, a very different outlook on life. I understand that, but that doesn't mean it's going to interest me, and it didn't. It was so tedious and so deliberate and so ponderous.
Is because this is one of the first films about Vietnam where the war isn't front and center,
right,
where it's sort of very far in the background. And it shows people going through tragedies and ups and downs. And the young woman who plays both the character at the age of 10 and the character later at the age of 20, both of those women are fantastic actresses. I think the film is going to be a major Oscar
But they're
contender.
Not, I don't think so. They're not given enough to do in the conventional sense of acting. They're so stoic and laid back that you're left saying, all right, get on with the story.
Well,
I know what they were trying to do.
It certainly has those traditional, slow, respectful rhythms.
Slow?
I found it fascinating.
Boy.
Well, next up is our family find section of the show, where we're glad to be able to recommend a rousing family film that's just opened up in theaters across the country. And this one is called Iron Will, and it tells the story of a South Dakota farm boy in 1917 who's determined to save the family farm and to earn enough money for college. How else? By entering a 500-mile dog sled race between Winnipeg, Canada and St. Paul, Minnesota.
Son, how old are you?
Almost 18.
This young man may be fighting Germans in a trench soon, Harper. A lot farther from home than he is right now. You're saying he's not man enough to run a dog race.
Let the kid race.
Let him race. He won't last through the first day.
I'll last as long as any man here, including you, mister.
And he does last, at least till the middle of the race, but just barely, as here, his faithful dog team pulls the sleeping, half-frozen hero toward help, just when he needs it most.
Gus. Oh, I fell asleep, didn't I? I would have died if it wasn't for you.
As the only American contestant left in the big race, the boy becomes an overnight hero as he discovers during a brief stop in a small town along his route.
I am well! I am well! My father said to give these to you. Said there's a few hundred miles left in them.
Thanks. My name's Will Stoneman. I think you might be confusing.
To us, you're Iron Will, American hero. That's what all the papers call you. You're on the front page every day. Every paper from here to New York City. Wait till you see. The whole country's rooting for you.
And I was rooting for this movie from start to finish. Talk about a major find. Mackenzie Astin is the brother of Sean Astin, who played Rudy, the son of Oscar winner Patty Duke, and also the son of John Astin of TV's The Addams Family. He carries the load playing Iron Will perfectly. He's a major new find, and this is a fine family adventure.
It sure is. He's just intensely likable, and so is the movie, partially because it has outstanding supporting cast. August Schellenberg plays about the same role he did in Free Willy. He's sort of a wise, all-knowing Native American
here,
farmhand.
He's a good actor.
But everybody's good. Kevin Spacey plays that newspaper man we saw there briefly, who's really an exploitative journalist, but he ends up having a heart of gold. Everybody ends up pulling for Iron Will, and certainly the audience is going to react that way, too, particularly kids. I mean, I love the fact that here you have the Disney company making a film that really honors some of the old traditions of that company.
Well, they make a movie every week, it seems, so they release a movie every week, but you're not going to release this movie in June. This is the perfect time of year for this movie. In some theaters, you'll walk out, it'll be colder outdoors than it was. I know someone who said that. It was colder outdoors nowadays than it was in the movie. But
well, last year they had a big success, Disney, with another movie about an offbeat winter sport, Cool Running, about the Jamaican bobsled team. He's even more of an underdog in his own way, Iron Will, and it's an even more offbeat winter sport, dog sledding. I don't think it's ever been rendered more excitingly on screen.
I only wish they'd cut one scene where he pulls a gun on that annoying Swedish champion and solves his problems with a gun. That's the one scene that I would object to. Other than that, it's first-rate family adventure. Well, next up is our Screen by Teen segment, in which our panel of young movie critics gives us their perspective on a movie just coming out on video. And in this case, it's Coneheads, last summer's movie about those lovable aliens from the early days of Saturday Night Live. In this scene, Earthling Chris Farley, a member of the current Saturday Night Live generation, is out on a date with Connie Conehead, who here gives new meaning to the term fast food.
So, both your parents from Europe, or...
Uh-huh.
When did they come to America?
Before I was born.
Yeah, my grandfather's from the old country.
Oh, really? Which one?
I'm not sure. One of the big ones.
Oh.
Wow! My mom's the only other woman I've ever known who could take a sandwich like that.
Well, now, Kelly, before you consume mass quantities, what did you think of Coneheads?
Michael and Jeffrey, one of the most favorite things for me to do is go home and watch all the old reruns of Saturday Night Live. One of my favorite skits is the Coneheads, because they're just, like, so stupid, and it makes, like, no sense, but it's still funny. And when I saw the movie, I was kind of disappointed, because it was just, everything was so real. Like, the cones had, like, all these veins and stuff, and Dan Aykroyd and Jane Curtin, they were playing them like real characters, and it just didn't have the same feel to it, because on the show, it was, like, campy and stupid, and it wasn't meant to be like that.
Yeah, see, I'm riding the fences on this one. I liked it because I thought I was going to have to see the old skit with Dan Aykroyd and the original characters to understand the jokes now, but luckily for me, they had the new characters on SNL.
Yeah.
I watch it now, and I like those guys like Dennis Lear and everything. He was great.
Yeah.
But I didn't like it because the script just seemed lame, and it just wasn't funny to me.
Yeah.
I think the best part about it was something you said. You said it was really real. Dan Aykroyd, even on the TV show, played the Conehead man really well. It was really done well on the whole character. The special effects were dazzling. I liked it. Rob was riding the fence on it, and Kelly did not like it at all. Go check it out. It's coming on video. Back to you, Kelly.
Well, I guess the humor there was just too juvenile for them, but we liked it. Now to summarize our reviews of all the six titles we covered this week, there's no best bet since we disagreed on almost everything. Jeff enjoyed Intersection, for instance, though he admits it's just a glitzy bit of romantic fluff, but I thought it was totally lame with a main character who's so shallow, so dislikable, it's impossible to care about him. There's some harsh language and a few scenes of mostly dysfunctional sex. We disagree again on Blink, which Jeff found dreary and derivative, but where I thought the sizzling romantic chemistry between Aidan, Quinn, and Madeline Stowe redeemed its gimmicks. There's an abundance of harsh language, some very intimate graphic sex scenes, and a great deal of vivid violence. On Far Away So Close, Jeff found himself bored and indifferent, but I was fascinated by its haunting insights and images. There are a few harsh words in several languages, and a few scenes of violent confrontations. Jeff was bored once again by The Scent of Green Papaya, which to him held all the allure of a cooking video, but I thought it was a sensual, intriguing view of a lost world of a princely merchant family in Saigon. There are some mild, subtle scenes of sexual content, but no violence or tough language. And on our family find, we finally agree, Iron Will is a terrific outdoor adventure in the best Disney tradition. There are a few scenes of violence, but nothing at all shocking or graphic. And our Screen by Teens panel split 2-1 against Coneheads, which both Jeff and I liked. It's rated PG, with no violence or language, but a few comical scenes of extraterrestrial sex between husband and wife.
So that's it for this week's show. Join us next time when we'll have a special show for you, since most everyone agrees that 1993 was an excellent year for movies. And with Oscar nominations coming next month, don't forget, we'll look back at all the films we saw last year and present our choices for the best pictures of the year. The classics, the dramas, and the comedies, and the epics, all in our special sneak previews, the best films of the year. I'm Jeffrey Lyon.
And I'm Michael Medved. And until next time on Sneak Previews, don't forget to save us the aisle seats.